Hello everyone, so welcome to the afternoon session. So the second talk of is in R3 is PyMetheus, a Python-based monitoring system using Raspberry Pi. So let's welcome Ing-Wei Tang will take this presentation.
Hello, good afternoon, fellow Pythonista in PyCon Taiwan 2021. Today, my talk is about my own project, PyMetheus, a Python-based monitoring system using Raspberry Pi. And this is one of the, and of course, if you look at the name, I actually borrowed the same name from Prometheus. And this is a presentation about my work. First, we'd like to look at what my talk is about today. Of course, my talk for today will focus on monitoring. And of course, my motivation over to start this project, what will be the architectures of PyMetheus, as well as what is the monitoring mechanisms behind PyMetheus. Together, I'll end this talk with example and demo that I have demonstrated and also built for this talk. Before we go into the talk, let me introduce myself. I was the previous speaker for PyCon Taiwan 2019, as well as I was the chair for PyCon Malaysia 2019. My day job is senior network automation in a shared services company. Together, I've been speaking in quite many PyCon, as well as like what I mentioned before, PyCon Taiwan 2019. This photo was taken in PyCon Taiwan 2019, as I believe we had the physical event at Academia Sinica, which I have been there for two times, I remember. And it was quite a memorial session because this was an event that hosts before COVID happened. I'm also the lead for the web design team for PyCon APAC 2020 and 2021, and it has given me a quite good experience in web designing. So since we're talking about monitoring, what do we know about monitoring? First, of course, monitoring helps us to look at few aspects of the system or services. Particularly, we're looking at the service availability. We'd like to look at the service health, as well as the new words for nowadays. We're talking about the observability, which we'll use that not just for debugging, for logging, as well as making decision in terms of whether we want to expand the system or we want to scale the system according to the data that we get from the monitoring. Together, we also like to know the internet state of the system that we host, the service that we host on the platforms. For example, we have services hosted in cloud or on-premise or everything. Or at the same time, we also like to look at how responsive the monitoring it is. For example, we like to know how fast the monitoring, the data for the monitoring give us the insight or the event or the alert that we get from the system itself. So monitoring actually is about how we know about the system and how we can get the response and respond to the system when things happen. The types of monitoring that we get normally that we can see is system monitoring. For example, we have a lot of different kind of tools, monitoring tools in Unix and Linux system, as well as nowadays we're talking about, since we're talking about services, we have application monitoring, APNs. For example, we have quite numbers of them. Elasticsearch is one of it, Datadog is one of it, and we have a few more to mention. And coming from my background, we also have a few network monitoring systems. For example, if those are being in network space, we know about Thousand Eyes, that's one of it, and SolarWinds, which previously used, and CAPM. We have number more to mention about network monitoring. Together, we still have some other network intrusion detection, which we use to detect whether there's intrusion happens to the network. And one old tools that I remember we snort, but probably nowadays we don't use it. Maybe we have something better tools to use nowadays for intrusion detection. So what's the main problem with the current monitoring tools that I mentioned just now? According to my experience with that, all the tools, especially one I've been dealing with recently, which is one called Thousand Eyes, has been too costly. As well as some monitoring tools are too large to handle. When I mean by too large to handle, it means by it has too many functionalities that normally we don't really use it. Maybe we just use for one or two tools within the monitor tools itself. At the same time, sometimes some monitoring tool will give us a lot of information that will, sometimes it might lose our focus on getting the data that we want or getting the information that we want. At the same time, we also having an issue with false alarm within the monitoring tools that normally that we choose. For example, it might have some events, it might have triggered some events that we don't think is an issue, but it turns out to be an issue for the system. And not to mention that some monitoring tools are built to have a single function. For example, some network monitoring tools, it will just focus on monitoring the network behavior of the network devices. You know, it's not really a device that will give you an all round of the whole network. So we have few feedbacks on that, and this triggers me to think of, okay, what would be the best monitoring tools for myself if, let's say, I want to have something small. Now, back to the story, the audience might ask why I started this and why can't Prometheus fit into my project or why can't Grafana fit into my project on that. Now, I have experience with Prometheus before that, which was 1 year ago on building this, you know, the standard package of Prometheus, Grafana, Docker on my Raspberry Pi 3B. Now, things ran greatly and I really loved those tools for the first 6 hours. And after 6 hours, I decided to say, probably this might not be a good thing for myself. Why? Because first thing, when I was very happy with Prometheus and Grafana on my Raspberry Pi 3B, I started to add a lot of different kinds of services. For example, DNS monitoring. Yes, I do have my own DNS system in my home. And together with, like I mentioned before, Raspberry Pi monitoring, as well as the speed test monitoring. However, after I add those services, and after 6 hours, I find that Raspberry Pi begins to freeze, and it experiences intermittent freeze since then, meaning that from here, it starts, you know, shut down by itself, it's got hand and not responding to my command after for a few times. And till now, I still have the same problems. I'm not too sure whether this is due to the Prometheus or the motherboard itself, but sometimes when I want to start my Raspberry Pi, it took me a few times to restart the system. After a long research from that, I find that actually Prometheus needs at least 4 gig of RAM, but my Raspberry Pi 3B actually has about 1 gigabit of RAM, so it is not quite suitable for myself. And of course, other monitoring system might not be suitable because, you know, for most of the monitoring system nowadays, it might need at least 2 gig of RAM. So why don't I take the opportunity? Why don't I take the opportunity to start PyMetheus and then use that for myself? So looking at pictures itself, well, this is my current so-called the data center setup. I have my Raspberry Pi 3B, as I pointed, which is mounted on the sky, as well as I have the CUPS printer server at the ground, which serves as a printer driver for my printer, because my printer is not wireless printer or network printer. So as you can see from that, there's a one which is the one I mentioned, the subject for today, Raspberry Pi 3B, as well as the other part. Okay, and down there it was a big NAS drive from that. So I call this a sky server all the time because this server and this Raspberry Pi is hosted in the sky because it's mounted on the sky. It never have a grounds on that. And getting this idea actually is coming from the Microsoft or having their data center built underneath the sea. So I say, why don't I just build something called the sky server? At the same time, I have another server which is called what I call as ground server. It's like I mentioned before, this is a CUPS server that handles the printing for my network. Now, speaking of all this data center, I noticed that I'm seeing something very interesting when I visited PyCon Taiwan 2019. I saw this, what I think local called as guai guai, which means be a good boy. And reason for it to be green, after I research it, it says that all the machine has to be green in order to be, you know, to have a good service or to have to function properly. And in most data center, and if I googled it, I found that most data center in Taiwan will have this, and even in PyCon Taiwan 2019, they have this one packet on top of the machine just to make sure that the machine is great. Now, I find that this is very interesting, and I believe that this is a local belief to make sure that machine is running accordingly all the time. Now, of course, around the world, we have different kind of the belief as well. So we respect the Mother Nature. We know that for every kind of service, you know, we always do some kind of rituals for that. But our curiosity never stops on Mother Nature. And this is why we have physics, because we want to understand what is behind Mother Nature's and what is the beauty of it. So in this case, monitoring is one of a way to help us to understand the Mother Nature in this case. So let's say, how do we get started with PyMetheus on that? But to me, PyMetheus have really started just, you know, as a project itself, but rather I started with something that is very simple. Now, one thing that I suspect after the project for PyMetheus is, PyMetheus, which is initially I started, I find that maybe my Raspberry Pi has too high temperature when I write some kind of services. So first version of it, I decided to write two scripts, which one will be the temperature monitoring. As you can see, this is just a simple Python script that gets the temperature of the Raspberry Pi, and then I write it to a log. Together, I have also one monitoring script that checks whether the port is open. So in this case, I have few services running on this Raspberry Pi, like Postgres is one of it. So port 5432 is one of the ports that I'll monitor all the time. So after having this monitoring, I'll write this data into a log file. Okay, I'll keep this into a log file. Now, having a log file is not quite useful, actually, especially in terms of troubleshooting. Now, log file gave us one information which is very important, which is the history about what happens in this machine. By means, when I say history, it means that what are the past events that happens on that. So for this log, it will tell you that everything is running right. So what you check on the log is you are trying to look for the event that things are not happening in this case. So looking back at two discretes over there, this actually generates a lot to tell us what was the event that will give us the machine is functioning well when things are not going well at during the time. So it is good for us to do a post-mortem analysis, but you know, it's not quite good for us to do a real-time alert, meaning that it can't trigger the thing when things go wrong. So after a design, looking at this, I say, okay, since this does not give me a lot of information, but it just tell me when the event happens, so I decided to say, well, maybe time to have me to look at that. And at the same time, I find that there's no matrix for me to have a reference over on this thing. So like I mentioned, why don't I start something new? So I begin to research on the current structures on PyMetheus, and I decided to look into my own project, which is PyMetheus. So I decided to name it PyMetheus after, you know, a failed experience from PyMetheus. So I say PyMetheus is a monitoring system that is written in Python. And of course, it is inspired by a few things that I learned along the line, which is Ansible, PyMetheus, Grafana, and other big boys like I mentioned before. Thousand Eyes is one of the things that inspired me a lot and told me how to do the thing. Now, of course, the audience again will ask the same question: why, you know, you have other tools around, why you have to start something new today? Now, for me, I find that it has always been very interesting for me to start something, a new project, because I can learn along the line to know, you know, to come up with the system design, to build the system and understand. Of course, in this case, understand Python more in terms of building it, because when you engage in a project, you find that you learn something about Python all the time in building that. And also for this project, I have learned quite a lot of things about Python again, even though I'm been writing Python for numbers of years, but I still find that I still have new things to learn along. Or for writing Python. And of course, I would like to share this project because, you know, I always believe that there are someone out there who has the same problem as mine. And, you know, sharing is caring, like as always, you know, kicks rhymes singing, sharing is caring. So I decided, say, why don't, if I have built this project successfully, why don't I just share this? Okay, so a little bit of features about PyMetheus. So PyMetheus is written in Python version 3. So we have couples of the packages running along, which is PS utilities, PyCycops, and I'll explain why PyCycle, request, PyTest, and trading in this case. Now, the good features about PyMetheus over here is it is actually written in a very small code base. Now, when I say a small code base, it means by something that is less than perhaps 5 MB. So for the current code base that I have, I think by crude measure, by simple measure, I have about 2 MB. So it is less. And at the same time, what makes this PyMetheus interesting is it runs on a Python and it runs on a very small memory footprint. And to my measurement, I find that actually it's just not less than 512 MB, but probably is less than that. So having a 512 MB is just a minimal requirement for that. And comparing this to a contemporary monitoring system like PyMetheus itself, it needs about 4 GB of memory. But of course, maybe they have other architectures as well. And speaking of this PyMetheus, and this is of course, this is a focus on PyMetheus itself, is a modular. It has the modular. When I say modular in this case is it has different modules that caters your need, and you can take this modular. At the same time, you can also write your own modules to add in this PyMetheus. Now, the main philosophy of this PyMetheus itself is you decide what to monitor. Like I mentioned in early, sometimes when it comes to monitoring system that gave you too much information that sometimes you don't know what to choose. Now, in this monitoring system, PyMetheus allows you to decide what you want to monitor. For example, if you want to monitor CPU, you choose to monitor CPU. If you want to monitor memory, you choose to monitor memory. If you, let's say, you want to choose a particular services like Redis, or maybe in this case, MySQL, you choose to monitor the features on it. So you can definitely craft this module easily according to your need. What is the architecture that behind PyMetheus? PyMetheus uses a very simple client and server model. So in this case, when you check out on my GitHub today, you find that PyMetheus will have two common components. One will be client and one will be the server. So for the client, rather than, you know, compared to PyMetheus will be the collector and going to all the clients to collect the information. But for my case, I think it will be a little bit reversed from that. Clients will be the one that collects the information about the system and then send it to the server. While when the servers receive the information from the client, servers will record this data into the database, and there's another end that will do the reporting for the health of the client. So it is fairly a simple architecture on that. And there are a few components in this case that we're looking at for PyMetheus today. So first thing, as I mentioned before in my talk today, we're going to look at the client on the Raspberry Pi, and together, as I mentioned before, which my subject, which is on the Raspberry Pi 3B, things can be installed in Raspberry Pi. But of course, when this thing, the client is crafted or built, it's not just for Raspberry Pi, but it can be anything itself. So of course, like I mentioned before, client can be called as aggregator, and client can be customized. You choose what to monitor, and as well as you can choose to write this client according to your need. For example, you can put it as into cron, or you can run it as a demo daemon today, as what I'm going to demo today in my talk today. And like I mentioned before, it contains a few different kinds of modules. You can choose to monitor CPU, memory, hard disk, network, POCs, service. HTTP is something that is derived from service monitor on the DBMS. So that's the spirit. You can customize what you need to do for the client. For the server side, the server is written actually by Flask. It's a fairly simple HTTP REST API. And you can run this web app or this server in any machine. So right now, I have my server running on my Windows machine, which is a machine that I'm presenting right now. At the same time, this web app will have three REST endpoints, which is register, collect, and heartbeat. And for notify, currently I'm still engaging in some kind of the development. So for this talk, I'm not going to announce for the notify in this case. I mentioned before, we have a database over there. Postgres is the default database, and I haven't really started to look at different type of database such as SQLite or MySQL or maybe MSSQL. So right now, Postgres is the main database to have. And this Postgres right now is being hosted on Docker. Okay, thank you. Now this is a ER diagram for the database, and this is what we have on that. So it contains two parts, the inventory as well as the event. Grafana is the main reporting system, so we use that for that, for the Grafana. And reason for Grafana is it's very easy to use. This is the main page of the Grafana from that. Okay. And the mechanism of the monitoring is very simple. We collect, like I mentioned before, we collect all the data, goes to the server records the data into the DB and display from the Grafana. So for this alert, we're going to do that in the future. Okay, so for that, I'm also looking into how we can integrate that into a third-party software, for example, like maybe in terms of Java or Golang or other languages, because in this structure, actually, we use a lot of the JSON structure to communicate. So things are getting quite simple in this case because we use JSON on that. Okay, a simple client for that. So this is a simple client that I started to test with, which is testing on the CPU. So first thing, in order to keep the data into the ER diagram or database, first thing we have to register on, register into a device. We have to register that because we like to know which device has been used for monitoring. So once you have registered the device, then we'll put the event that we're going to monitor. Monitor CPU is the one that we get. We like to monitor CPU is the one, and event is the one that we like to collect the event and send to the database. So for this, it is very simple. We just need to write this and post the event according to 5 seconds on the time. So a little bit demo for this, which I've written for this Postgres database. So let me just release myself a little bit. Okay, so as you can see right now from here from the screen, this is actually running by for now, which is I use it for that. And the code itself is fairly simple. So like I mentioned before, the structure is very simple as the example for CPU. We just need to register a device, and then you add in to your service. What are your services that you want to monitor? In this case, we just need to monitor the Postgres on my Raspberry Pi 3, as well as the port that I'm used together with the, you know, with the IP address and port from that. And once I'm done registering the device, then I just need to add these three different monitoring systems into my daemon. So actually this is running at daemon. So from that, for every time of it, if you look at that, actually it is posting the event into my server. So once the server received my event, what we can look at from that is this is the current event that we have for the Postgres monitoring. So actually it's quite simple, and when you use the Postgres running, it will tell you all the information over that. So currently my the Postgres on the Raspberry Pi has been running quite well over the time. So I'm quite happy with this. So even though this is still a very simple dashboard for that, it allows me to do the monitoring easily from that. Okay. So with that, that ends with my demonstration. So a few future roadmaps that we're looking at, Docker is one of it that we'd like to look at, Kubernetes as well. And particularly, the most important thing is I'm actually more interested to get this into a YAML, because like what I did before, I find that using some of the features kind of troublesome. So I'm thinking of whether I can implement YAML into that. And prior to that, actually, I have YAML, but just I have quite some commitment. Therefore, I haven't really built the system yet. This is the pull request. So if you are interested with the project, you can start to look into my repo and do a pull request. Questions? Okay, so any questions will do in this case. Both English and Mandarin are welcome.
Okay, let's see if we have any question at this title.
Apparently, no.
Okay, I have one question.
Cool.
Because we also have many PC or some the other servers in our lab. So one problem is sometimes our air condition is broken.
Okay.
And sometimes so we have to set some temperature meter. Can you expand this by a temperature meter or fans?
Okay.
Good question,
Dr. Huan from there. Now, having this, when you have a Raspberry, let's say when you install this client into a Raspberry Pi in this case, then you can have your temperature sensors mount to your Raspberry Pi so it can intercept. So back to the, back to the code structure, as we can see from there. Yeah, so okay, so just give me a moment.
Yes.
So from there, actually, you can craft this thing very easy. So you just need to write your own monitoring system from here, and then you just get that data. So basically looking at all this from here, my monitoring, blah, 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 get this. This is your own monitoring system. Mm. So you can write your own monitoring system and then pass the data from here. So you just need to pass the data. So from there, let me just show you the event. The event is actually very, very, very simple. So you just need to pass the event type, and then you put the event value, event message, and event status. So for Prometheus, not Prometheus, for Grafana, these are very simple. You just need to pass the value, and then you map the value to the status. For example, let me back to this here. This one, if you look at that, it always says okay. But what are the things that lies behind it? What are the things? I have a mapper down there.
Okay.
I have a mapper. Okay, error, critical, warning. So if you look at that here, there's always a value from here. So this actually is wrong. It should be 4. You can't map it. So yeah. So you can craft it. And this is why I choose Grafana eventually. Because it is when people look at Grafana, actually it's quite complicated, but actually it's very simple to learn. It's not that difficult, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. So rather than, spending your time writing the JavaScript and all the thing, and of course, before that, I actually thinking of using, Streamlight on everything. But to me, I think that rather than, I spend time to write all the JavaScript to display my data, why don't I just use, in this case, Grafana, and look at it. You can just craft your SQL query easily for the database easily. So you don't need to worry about all this thing, all the technical details behind it, and you don't even need to worry about all this thing, like refresh. And even I can trace back all things. Like even I have 24 hours, I have some running at the back, so it can trace tells me what things happen. But of course, in this straight line, it is not a good data because it has been, I have not been collecting the data over this period of time. So I have some errors from there.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is, I believe that somebody will have the same problem as myself. So it is, it's built for something that you want to have a small monitoring system, but you don't want really like, look at a ready software which sometimes you don't understand how it works. So this gives us a learning experience on how to get the thing works from there. So I try to make this API as simple as possible so that when you start to craft, let's say this thing, you just need to enter the API for that. So this app daemon itself is also very simple. You just tell me this is the data that I want to collect, and I'll collect with a period of 60 seconds for every interval. So for this display over here, as you can see, this display over here, this consists of, like I mentioned before, get the connection, numbers of connection. So you refresh 60 seconds every time. DB health, this will be connection status. Get Postgres status every 60 seconds. Get memory info. So this is the memory info. So this is the memory usage that right now I have on my Raspberry Pi. So it's about 50%. So let's say in this case, you can even set your threshold. Let's say your 50% is too high for you, then you can have that. So things are fairly easy, and you can craft that things easily. So for example, right now, since no question from that, so I'll just show.
There is a question coming. So okay. So do consider the combine the client and server to the same.
Good question, actually. So I'm actually also thinking of same thing as well. But during writing this, actually, I'm writing this repo in parallel, so I didn't have the time to combine that. But in fact, this audience has asked another very good question, an extension to it. I'm also thinking of putting my another YAML repo together with this. So yeah, there's a high chance that I'll put them together. Yep. So back to the question for Dr. Huan. So this is actually, you can look at the derivative. I have something called monitor service, because I think that literally everything is a services. So here, as a derivative, I have a HTTP service, which I monitor a few things. Status, respond time, and of course, this is actually not needed. So this to get status and get respond time. So since you can inherit this from the class, the main class itself, you can build anything that you want. For example, for this DBMS, I inherit this from the monitor service. I can do a connect to a DB, get activity, get status, you know. I can inherit and build anything that I want. So for your case over there, you can start writing this from here, services. You can start with these services and get into the type of monitoring. Let's say you can just write a method, monitor temperature. Then you start to code how you want to get the temperature from the environment.
From the device.
Yeah. So things are quite simple over there. And I believe that is all for my talk today. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.